has brought me to this place. Because of you, I freely live my life to you, oh God, I give. So I stand before you, God. I lift my voice 'cause you set me free. So I shout out your name. From the rooftops I proclaim that I am yours. I am yours. All the good you've done for me, I lift up my hands for all to see. You're the only one who brings me to my knees to share this love across the earth. The beauty of your holy word. So I kneel before you, God. I lift my hands 'cause you set me free. So I shout out your name. From the rooftops I proclaim that I am yours. I am yours. All that I am, I place into your loving hands, and I am yours. I am yours. Here I am, I stand with arms wide open to the one, the Son, the everlasting God, the everlasting God.
See you this morning and welcome. Welcome back.
It's actually good to be back. For a number of you, I've been gone for a couple weeks. I had surgery, and so I've been regrouping for the past couple weeks. And I appreciate your prayers and the support you've given myself and my wife and obviously the church. So thank you so much. I wanted to mention also, this year we're going to do a project called Neighbor Reach. And we did it last year for the first time. What we're trying to do is get out into the community and to cross a bridge and let people know church just isn't on Sunday mornings. It's actually during the week, and we are the church, and the church can mobilize and go out and actually help people. Matthew 5:16 says, the concept is let your light so shine among men that they will see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. And that's what we're trying to do. So last year, on the 30th of April, the last Saturday, we had, I think it was 11 churches, 300 people on 42 or 43 sites throughout the county doing projects, from raking leaves to putting on roofs to all sorts of things for the city here, too. It was very, very good. And those of you who, why don't you stand up if you were involved last year, please? Okay, that's what I thought. See, so thank you. You can be seated. So I trust you'll want to do it again. And here's the T-shirt that we have. It says Neighbor Reach. And the goal, one of the interesting things we did is we painted fire hydrants. There's some 600, I think, fire hydrants in the community, and we painted over 100 of them. And people said, well, how can painting fire hydrants help? And it was your team, Joyce, but one of the fellows came out from one of the houses when some of the folks were out painting the fire hydrant in front of his house, and he says, I'm so glad you're here so that I can finally have someone to talk to. He had been taking care of his family and had been housebound, and just being able to talk to somebody was a great experience for him. So at the end of the day, we had a dinner up at Fellowship Hall with all the different churches, and it was really fun. And so I trust that you will do this. If you have a T-shirt from last year, don't sign up for another one. But other than that, please do sign up. It's in the back. And Marcia Goddard is there. She can answer any questions you got for that. So please get involved.
Just a note on that. We had a great time on that. Oh, no, you're done.
No.
No, you're done.
We're going to show a video.
Oh.
So let's watch the video.
God of this city, you're the king of these people, you're the Lord of this nation. You're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. Is no one like our God. For greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the God of this city, you're the king of these people, you're the Lord of this nation. You are, you're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. Greater things are yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things are yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things are yet to come, and greater things are still to be done. There is no one like our God. There is no one like you, God. The greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done.
Churches, over 300 people. Out of those 300 people, over 100 people were from Calvary. And proud of you. It was interesting. Somebody told me that they walked into Dunkin' Donuts. They had their shirt on. And the person behind the counter says, what is this neighbor reach? And they said, well, there's 11 churches all getting together to work in the community or in the county of Rutland. They said, it'll never happen. I go, neener, neener. It happened. And we're looking forward to it. And so it's a great day. If you can make it, do it. Thank you.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and he carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah. Lord of all, body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all. Sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all our hope. Sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all, Jesus Messiah.
Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning. We thank you that we can come together and hear beautiful singing and listen to your word. And we pray that your word will reward us and guide us and give us insight on how to act, how to live, how to be a demonstration and a display of your love. Thank you that Dave's back with us, and we pray that you will continue the healing process in Dave and fully restore him to his health. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning I'm going to try and give you my insight and a little help from God's Word, a lot of help from God's Word, on how to answer the question, what's in a name? We're going to read some scripture. I'm going to tell you a story. I'm going to try to tie it all together and send you home with a challenge. So let's look to God's Word. I want you to turn to Ephesians chapter 1. And we're going to begin verse 3 to the first part of verse 14. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we would be holy and blameless before him in love, he predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to himself, according to the kind intention of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, which he freely bestowed upon us in Christ. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished on us. In all wisdom and insight, he made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his kind intention, which he purposed in Christ, with a view to the administration suitable to the fullness of the times, that is, the summing up of all things in Christ, things in the heavens and things in the earth in Him. Also, we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to His purpose, who works all things after the counsel of His will, to the end that we, who were the first to hope in Christ, would be to the praise of His glory. In Him you also, after listening to this message of truth and the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, you were sealed in Him with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is given to us as a pledge of our inheritance. I was named after my grandfather, George Clyde Atkins. And for several years when I was a little bitty boy, I really resented my name. Now, Atkins, that's okay. That's a widely respected British name of British origin. And George was pretty cool, also British origin. Name given to a lot of nobles and presidents and kings and famous generals. That was pretty cool. But right in the middle, they stuck me with the name Clyde. And when you're down south, people turn Clyde into a two-syllable word and it sounds like Clyde. Clyde. You know, sounds like something automobiles do on an icy road. Also, when it's said that way, it kind of has this kind of a redneck ring to it, worse than Bubba or Cooter or something like that. And there really wasn't too many notable Clydes where I came from. Now, I'm sure there were, but the only two that I can recall was the infamous Clyde Barrow of gangster epi, you know, Bonnie and Clyde. And there was this novelty song during the time by Ray Stevens called Ahab the Arab. And he had this camel named Clyde. And it would go running through the desert making all these obnoxious sounds. So, you know, I wasn't too hip on the name Clyde or Collide. So, you know, I thought I could hide it. You know, that's my middle name, you know, George C. You know, C stands for Charles or Chris or, you know, something cool. But you can't do that down south. You just can't. Jacob, correct me if I'm wrong, but Southern women have an inherent quality, particularly mothers and school teachers. When you upset them, they're going to address you by your full name. George Clyde Atkins, you do that again, I'm going to skin you, boy. You know. Sarah Elizabeth Atkins, if you don't eat those butter beans, you're going to do the dishes. You know. So there's no way you can hide it. And kids, oh, kids are so cruel. And there's always this one kid on the playground that makes life miserable for you. And he used to come up. I know your initial is C, that stands for camel. That was the straw that broke the proverbial camel's back. No pun intended. So I'd had about enough of it, and what do? You know, like all really intelligent young six-year-olds, I hauled off and hit him. And he hauled off and hit me back. And then we have this fight on the school playground, and the teacher comes out yelling, George Clyde Atkins, I'm going to take you to the principal's office. And I'm sitting there, boy, you really did that one well, didn't you? You know, now the whole playground knows. You know, and as I grew up, things got better, but I still resented my name. But I started hearing stories about my granddaddy. I never knew him. He died when my father was a young boy back in the 1930s. And this was during the Depression and everything. And I'd sit around and listen to the aunts and uncles, and they would tell me stories, tell us all stories about my granddaddy. And he was an interesting fellow. He worked as a foreman on one of the big farm ranches in the area. Didn't make a lot of money, but it was work, and it was the Depression. And back then, people didn't do what they do now. There wasn't a whole lot to do for entertainment, particularly in places I grew up, like Max Meadows and Porter's Crossroads and Cripple Creek, Virginia. You can imagine there's not a whole lot for people to do to entertain themselves. And even if there was, wasn't a lot of money, you know. So they would visit. What a novel concept. People would visit each other. And my granddaddy, he played several instruments. He used to sing. And the big thing that people, I should say, the thing people used to enjoy doing, they would come to my grandmother's house, and they would make music, and they would listen to my grandfather tell stories. And he was an avid reader. He consumed books like they were Fritos, you know? And he couldn't get enough to read, and he loved Westerns. He loved cowboy books. I mean, he read every Zane Grey novel that was ever written. It's a shame he had to die before Louis L'Amour started publishing, you know? But and people would come and they would want him to tell the latest story, the latest book that he read. And he would tell of Riders of the Purple Sage and the Wilderness Trail. And I remember my uncle saying one night he really threw a curve at him because he had just finished reading Tarzan of the Apes by Edgar Rice Burroughs. They enjoyed that. And so I said, you know, that's pretty cool. But I still resented my name. Clyde. Still. Oh man, why didn't you just name me Cooter, you know? But all that changed. One day in 1968, it was late August. And I don't know how many of you remember the year 1968. If you got gray hair like me, you probably do. But 1968 was not one of the greatest years in our country's history. It was a year filled with violence, racial tension, rioting from coast to coast. We were in the middle of a very controversial war that caused rioting coast to coast, violent rioting. And even something as docile as the Democratic National Convention turned into a series of violent riots in Chicago. And aside all that, within the period of about 3 months, two major leaders in our country was assassinated, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and Senator Robert Kennedy. So there was a lot of violence in our country, a lot of tension, a lot of anger. And I was thumbing to school one morning. School hasn't actually started yet. It was, like I say, late August, and we were caught up in the middle of two-a-day football practices, so I'm thumbing to football practice, hitchhiking, you know, that's how I got around back then, you know, what they call a shanks mare, hitchhiking, thumbing. But I'm thumbing to school to practice, and this car stops. And I look in, there's this elderly African-American couple, and they pulled over to give me a ride. And in the back seat was a young man that I went to school with, Larry Carson. He was a year younger than me. But you gotta remember, 68 in Virginia, they had just integrated the schools maybe 2 years earlier. And people were still getting used to the idea of integration. And it was one of those things that never bothered me at all. You know, Hey, this is cool. Some of my friends I now get to go to school with. This is kind of a cool deal. But anyway, I get in the car, and Larry makes introductions, and the elderly couple was his grandparents. They were driving him to practice. And the gentleman said, I would wager that you were the grandson of Mr. George Glide Atkins. I said, yes, sir, I am. Thank you. But I never knew my grandfather. I was named after him, but he died 30 years ago. I shook his head and said, yep, I remember. I said, I knew your granddaddy. I said, when I was a teenager about your age, my father, his brothers, and my brothers would all get our livestock together, and we would drive them over Whiffle Mountain, which was one of the big mountains, to the bigger city, and we would trade with the traders when they came. We'd do that about once, twice a year, and we always went by the farm and asked if your granddaddy could go with us, and they usually said, yeah, sure, because he farm had livestock they could trade too. So we'd get together and we'd drive the livestock over the mountain, and your grandfather always brought along either a guitar or a banjo, and we would make music, and then he would tell us about the latest book he had read. He said it was so good. He would tell a story and you thought you were right there on the adventure with it. We thought we were out west in a cattle drive having a grand adventure. And I was really impressed because I could see as he talked, you know, here was a man that was, even as young as I was, I could tell he was, from his countenance, from the way he talked, he was enjoying a memory. And he said, yeah, I used to really look forward to those times when we would drive the livestock. And then he got real serious and he said, but the important thing you should know about your granddaddy, he went with us because Mr. George knew that those white traders would not try to cheat or take advantage of us as long as he was with them. Whew! I got out of that car and I won't tell you, I was walking in some tall cotton. I really felt good, and from that day forth, I never really resented my name at all. And I made me a kind of a self-promise that I was going to try to live up to that name, live up to my granddaddy's example. You know, it was, to me, it was a heritage of integrity and justice and fairness. And at that time in our nation's history, our nation was trying to catch up to a heritage that had already been left to me. And I felt really special, not because of anything I'd done, but because of, you know, what was given to me. And I enjoy my name now. But I don't say Clyde, I say Clyde. There is a Y in there, you know. But we just read in Scripture, in Ephesians, that we have been given an inheritance, that we have a heritage. And it comes from a name that we carry. Now we're known, we're called believers in Christ. Okay. The Scripture we read talked about as believers in Christ. We belong to a family. And I want you to just stay in Ephesians there. This outlines what is involved with becoming a believer in Christ. You look in verse 13. After listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, that being that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and he came to earth, and he died on the cross. After believing in that, then go back up to verse 7, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. This is outlined in the whole God. This is what gets us into the family of God. Believing in Christ, confessing your sins, being forgiven of your trespasses, and being sealed. Again, verse 13 and 14. Being sealed with the Holy Spirit. That gets us into God's family. And then we're adopted as sons. If anyone in here has not been adopted into God's family and does not have this inheritance, does not have this heritage, please see me, Dave, Scott, any of the elders, or any of the men in this chapel, and we will make sure that we outline what it takes to become a member of God's family. And as a member of God's family, we have a name. There are several names in Scripture. We're called believers, brethren, disciples, saints. But the most common used is the word Christian. It might not be the most common used in Scripture, but over the years, that name has become synonymous with Christ's followers. And that's literally what the word means. Followers of Christ, believers of Christ, and the one I like is Christ's people. Because when you refer to yourself as, I'm one of Christ's people, that makes you, that gives you that family effect, if you will. These are my kind of people. They're Christ's people. The first time we see the word, I only seen three instances in Scripture where it was used, but the first time it was used was in Acts chapter 11, verse 26. Barnabas and Paul were in Antioch preaching and spreading the gospel. And if you want to go there, let me just go there real quickly. Acts 11, 26. And when he had found him, that's Barnabas finding Saul, or Paul, he brought him to Antioch. And for the entire year, they met with the church and taught considerable numbers. And the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. We see the term used again over in Acts chapter 28. Paul is on his way to Rome to stand before Caesar. And they stop, and he's confronted by King Agrippa. Acts 26, verse 27. King Agrippa, this is Paul addressing him. Do you believe the prophets? I know that you do. And then Agrippa replied to Paul, in a short time you will persuade me to become a Christian. Now that's a bold statement, because at that time in the early church, to claim that you're a Christian, now here's an official, Agrippa, you're going to persuade me to be a Christian. Saying something like that back then could land you as being the main course for the king's tigers and lions, you know. So that was a pretty bold statement. And then we see the term used again over in 1 Peter. Chapter 4, verses 15 and 16. Make sure that none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or a troublesome meddler. But if anyone suffers as a Christian, he is not to be ashamed, but it is to glorify God in his name. It's not a shame to suffer as a Christian. Today's world, a lot of people are kind of ashamed to claim that they're a Christian. because, you know, what used to be known as a Christian nation is not so much known as a Christian nation anymore. And people, you know, kind of hide their faith under a bushel. Well, you know, don't be ashamed of your name. We're to be proud of it, to be a Christian. Not an arrogant, uppity, I'm better than you kind of pride, but a thankful, committed pride. I'm thankful for what went before me. I'm thankful that I was thought of so much to have a name like Christian. And as I look back on it, you know, you can choose to either be that five-year-old kid that was ashamed of his granddaddy's name, or you can be someone who takes pride and is humble and thankful that Christ loved me enough to give me his name and make me one of his people, which we are. We talked about the inheritance. I just want to look at Ephesians again real quickly, because there's some things, you know, we need to focus on there. There's a lot we need to focus, but a few I'd draw your attention to. We're given every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. That's verse 3. You look at verse 3. Every spiritual blessing. One of the great blessings that's mentioned in this passage, and it's the way it's mentioned, it's not just given to us. I mean, it's heaped upon us. If you look in verses 6 through 8, to the praise of the glory of his grace, which he freely bestowed upon us in the beloved, in him we have redemption through his blood, forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished on us. And this is just my interpretation. This is just George talking at you. But the way Paul uses terms like freely bestowed and lavished upon us, grace is one great inheritance we have from our Lord. The grace he gave to us. What a heritage. Freely bestowed, lavished upon. I mean, I got this vision of grace being a silo filled with corn, and we're in the middle of that silo, and here comes all that grace coming down on us. Might sound dangerous, but that's the way I picture it. I mean, it's just an abundance of grace. What does inheritance mean in verse 5? We're adopted. We're part of the family. We are sons with Christ. And this is something that's not thought of lightly. That's not just a spur of the moment decision on God's part. He predestined it. We are part of the family of God. As part of the family of God, we have a name. We can truthfully say, if we've believed in Christ the way I outlined, that we are Christ's people. And they're good people. They're supposed to be anyway. But it's a good family to belong to. Verse 11 confirms our inheritance. Also, we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to his will. Another confirmation. Then verses 13 and 14, again, expound upon the fact that we are sealed in that family and nobody can take us out. Nobody can deny our inheritance based upon a false family claim. In him you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, Paul's putting the parameters out there, just because you're born in a nation that claims to be Christians, that don't make you a Christian. Just because you are a member of a church that claims to be a Christian church, whether it be the Baptist, the Methodist, the Catholic, Calvary Bible Church. That doesn't make you a Christian. But in Him, after you listen to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having believed, you were sealed in Him with the Holy Spirit of promise, which is given as a pledge of our inheritance. It's documented. Your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And God has not only His word, but He's got documented proof that we are a part of His family. We are a part of the family of God. All this said, it leads us to the last thing I want to talk about. Having the name of George Clyde Atkins did not make me like my grandfather. I certainly became proud of that name, and I was proud and looked with esteem at the man who I was named after. But having that name did not allow me to enjoy the heritage and the inheritance that He had given me. What allows us to truly enjoy our name Christian is how we live up to that name. It takes more than just having a name to have the reputation and the inheritance. Remember what I read from 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 15 and 16? Before it said we should not be ashamed to suffer as a Christian, but don't suffer as a thief, an evildoer, troublesome meddler. These are all things that Christians are capable of. And these are things that tear down your Christian name. But if you suffer like a Christian, that means you're bearing with Jesus. You're identifying yourself. He was mocked. He was spit upon. You think Clyde is being fun? You think it's bad to have somebody make fun of your name Clyde? Try having somebody spit on you, beat you, and call you, oh, you're supposed to be the Son of God. Get yourself down off that cross. That's what suffering is. We need to be willing to live up to the name we have. Look again, if you will. This is brought out in verse 12. To the end that we, who are the first to hope in Christ, would be to the praise of His glory. That is an obligation we have as Christians. We are to be the praise of our Father's glory, the praise of our brother's glory. And what that really means is that we are to be a display, a demonstration of the character of Christ. That's how we live up to our name. You say, how? Well, how do we do that, George? Well, this whole book is chock plumb full of recommendations, suggestions, commandments, directives, examples of how we're to live up to our name. But I'm In closing, I'm going to share a few and have us look at one very familiar passage, because this to me is the beginning. Turn to Philippians chapter 2. Verses 4 through 9. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself, taking upon the form of a bondservant, and being made in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even the death on the cross, which was a very humiliating, emotionally humiliating as much as physically painful. For this reason also, God highly exalted him and bestowed upon him the name which is above every name. And I'll humble us all this morning by saying we do have that name when we call ourselves Christians, Christ-like, Christ's people. In that passage, just a couple of ways that we can go about living up to our name. First of all, look not to your own interests. Don't be self-centered. Look to the interests of others. Secondly, show humility and grace. Let's go through a little logical progression here. Humility and grace. In Ephesians, I made a point out of showing how Paul makes a point that one of the spiritual blessings we inherited is grace. Not just grace, but a freely bestowed grace that was lavished on us. And if verse 12 tells us that we are to be a display and a demonstration of the character of Christ, then doesn't it seem reasonable that we would bestow upon others the same grace that was freely bestowed upon us? Therefore, showing grace and showing humility is probably one of the most excellent ways to live up to our name, to live up to the name Christian. Be willing to serve all. Be willing, as Christ did, to come to earth not grasping equality with God. Hey, if we're brothers with Jesus, then everything I just said gives us the right to say, well, I'm equal to Jesus. Well, let's hold off on that for just a minute. Jesus was equal to God, but he made himself, he emptied himself to a man. So we should empty ourselves to a man, like every other man. And we should not consider ourselves better than others, but we should serve others with the same kind of enthusiasm that Jesus served us, regardless of race, regardless of religion, regardless of gender, regardless of nationality, regardless of social status or political party. We're to serve all men, just like Christ served us. And that are some simple ways that we can go about living up to our name. Now, I say they're simple ways, but I come from the old school where simple is hard enough. You know, I'm not asking you to go out and sell your property and fly off to New Guinea and be a missionary, but there are simple ways in our everyday life and existence that we can go about living up to our name. But the first and the most important thing for maybe some of you, if you haven't become a part of God's family, you can do so today. Confess your sins. Believe that Jesus died as a substitute for you for your sins. And trust in God. Believe in Jesus, the Son of God, that he died on the cross for us. My challenge this week Go out and look for one of those simple ways in which you can live up to the name of Christian. Let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we do thank you that you loved us so much to bring us into your family. And I pray that if there is anyone here this morning that has not taken the invitation, acted upon the invitation to be a part of your family, that they will do so this morning. If there are any that haven't, please, just repeat after me. God, I'd like to be a part of your family. I would like to experience the grace that you have lavished on others. I am a sinner, and I want to be free and redeemed from my transgressions. Please forgive me through the blood of Jesus Christ. In Christ's name we pray. For the rest of us, Heavenly Father, help us to go forth and be a demonstration and a display of the love that you have shown to us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
You're the gentle voice that calls me to be near you. Since you rescued me, nothing is the same. You have promised me one day I will see you in heaven forever. Forever to sing, you're my everything. You're the melody my heart is always singing. You're the tender love that reaches to my soul. You have given me all that I have needed and prayed for and waited for. I was made for to bring you my everything. I know you're the one who loves me. My soul cries out to you. I'm told you will never leave me. I will let my praises ring. Lord, you are my everything. You have carried me when my heart is broken, and I know it all works out for good.